Welcome back, everybody. So we are going to show you an interesting demonstration about a standing sine wave. During the class, we have shown you that if I have two sinusoidal traveling waves traveling toward each other, if I calculate the superposition of the two waves, you are going to get a standing wave between these two sources. And here I have a setup which shows you a demonstration which produces standing sine wave. So here I have a function generator which is connected to two loudspeakers here. In the middle, I have a car which is carrying a microphone which can record the magnitude of the sound wave between these two speakers. And this microphone is again connected to a scope which actually shows you the digitized magnitude of the sound wave. The function generator is also tuned to produce a sound wave, produce wave at 80 hertz. And if I turn it on, I'm going to generate two traveling waves traveling toward each other. And this setup is designed such that they cancel, these two waves cancel exactly at the middle of the track. As you can see from this initial setup, I place the microphone in the middle, and you do see that from the scope, the magnitude of the sound wave is actually very small. It's almost very close to zero. This is actually because I have been placing the microphone in one of the nodes. So just a reminder, during the class, we discussed the nodes for on the standing wave. That is actually the place where, as a function of time, the magnitude of the wave is always zero. That we call it as a node. The distance between the nodes can be calculated, and we have did that during the class, and that is actually around, is actually just half of the wavelength of the traveling wave. So now what I'm going to do is to move the car around, and you can see on the scope, I can detect there's one node here, and it reached maximum value. If I go back, you can see now I can see a node here, and goes up, and goes down again, another node, another node here, etc. As we travel through the track, we can see that we can measure the position of the nodes. That's actually make a measurement of the distance between the nodes and see if we can get some insights about the speed of sound. So in the middle, the reading on my luder is 53.5 centimeter. If now I move this card around such that it detects another minima, now it's actually the second node, the reading on the track is 73 centimeter. If I calculate the difference, the distance this card have traveled, that's actually 19.5 centimeter. So this means that we have all the ingredients for the calculation of the speed of sound. That is actually 19.5 multiplied by a factor of 2, then that is actually the wavelength of the sound wave. And multiply that by 80 hertz, then you are going to get something like 343 meters per second. That is actually exactly what we have shown you, what you will predict when you have sound in room temperature. That the speed of sound is actually close to 340 meters per second. So now what I'm going to do is to change the angular frequency of the function generator by a factor of 2. If I reduce the angular frequency by a factor of 2, to something which is close to 440 hertz. What is going to happen is the following. So since the angular frequency is reduced by a factor of 2, therefore the wavelength to have to be increased by a factor of 2 to compensate. Therefore, you are going to see less number of nodes in this track. And that's actually to this demonstration here. So now I am in the middle. Therefore, the sound wave actually cancels exactly. If now I move away from the middle, you can see that it takes a lot longer to detect another node. As you can see from this demonstration, if I decrease the angular frequency by a factor of 2, then because the wavelength is increased by a factor of 2, therefore you expect a smaller number of nodes can be detected through this setup. And that's actually exactly what we will predict with our mathematics.